Welcome to our second biannual Emeriti lecture. My name is Michael Nauenberg, and I'm currently the president of our Emeriti faculty. Before starting the introductions, I'd like to make a few remarks. The talk will last about 45 minutes, and afterwards, you can ask questions. We'll pass a microphone for this purpose. Please wait till you get the microphone so that everybody can hear your question. Then after the talk, there will be refreshments outside, and you get a chance to talk with the speaker as well. I'd like to introduce now Professor Bill Doyle, who is one of our pioneering faculty in biology and a former dean of the science division. At Oaks College, Bill was a colleague of our speaker tonight, Jim Gill, and he will now introduce him.
I think we're showing our age by the way we walk. I have really been honored by being asked to introduce Jim Gill tonight. He's a person who I have admired from day one that he arrived, actually before he arrived officially, from the first time that I had a chance to interview with him. And I'd just like to go briefly through some of the history about Jim. Not to his research, but who he is, what he has done. I don't know how many of you know, but he received his PhD in geochemistry from the Australian National University. And in the early 1970s, our campus had the opportunity to develop one of the new colleges, which is later named Oaks College. And this college was designed originally by Ralph Guzman and J. Herman Blake to be a multicultural community where people would validate their cultural backgrounds but seek out and reach out and understand people with different backgrounds. But also within that, the desire was to develop a very strong science program within the college, especially the introductory science programs in the colleges, to try to convince more underrepresented students to go into the sciences and be not just role models, but really to represent what they would like to do for their future. The Earth Sciences Department had been awarded an FTE, or actually half of an FTE, and you have to remember at that time, colleges, faculty and colleges were 50% of their salary and time in the colleges, 50% of the time in the discipline. So Earth Sciences had recommended Jim Gill to the Oaks College group. The college hadn't started yet, but was planning and was hiring the initial faculty for that college. And we agreed that we would like to meet this young man, and we did. And I have to say that I was absolutely struck with the openness, that smile of his eyes, everything about him. I thought he would be a perfect fit. In addition, he represented Earth Sciences, not biology or microbiology, but a different discipline that I thought we should have represented for our students in Oaks College. So we agreed with Earth Sciences, and Jim Gill was offered position, and he accepted to start the fall of 1972. So he's a founding faculty member in Oaks College, as well as a founding faculty member of the science program within Oaks College, which has had marvelous reviews, both internally on the campus as well as externally, of what we were trying to do and were able to do. I found it fascinating this evening that Michael Jim introduced me to one of the students in 1974 who went through the science program, majored in geology, worked for the USGS for a period of time, is now working in the San Joaquin Valley, but he drove over tonight because of the talk by Jim and the influence that he had on him and his decision to be a geologist. Another student in those early years, first student of her family that went on to college, she ended up being the director in the National Science Foundation of the Ocean Sciences Program. This is the quality of students that not only we had, but people like Jim Gill, working with them in those early years, giving them the security of knowledge that they could succeed in science disciplines. In addition, Jim had a background in marine sciences. I'd like to point out that he was co-chief scientist on two marine expeditions, one in 1987, one in 1995, in the Mariana area, South Pacific, and also in 2004, along the Pacific coast as part of the MBARI, the Monterey Bay Aquarium Research Institute program. And I say that because he also was key in the development of the marine program that we have at Santa Cruz at the present time, as originally envisioned, which was a very broad cross-disciplinary group. And he was one of the people that we could always count on to show up for informal or formal activities. And again, he found the time, made the time to do it. For campus service, for those of you who are not sure, faculty in the UC system are evaluated on teaching, research, and service. And the service is in the discipline or in the community or in the on the campus. And Jim has chaired the Earth Sciences Department from 1986 to 89. Acting Dean of the Division of Graduate Studies and Research before they separated the two for a period of time in between permanent dean. And then he was a Vice Chancellor of the Division of Research from 1994 to the year 2000. That's when they separated the graduate division from the research division. And also he's a founder of the Monterey Bay Science Education and Technology Center. And he was involved in from 1993 to 1996 in getting that off the ground. Working with graduate students, I was surprised and pleased to see that during the time that he was on the, before retirement, 16 PhD students, doctoral students, earned their degree of working with them, 6 master's students, and also 10 postdoctoral researchers. Now this is important because these are people who have earned their doctorate degree but have come to work with Jim and Jim's lab to learn new techniques, new perspectives on things. It's very important. And he's bringing these people to this campus, to UC Santa Cruz, which certainly elevates the reputation of the campus and the recognition of the quality of science that's being done. He retired, I understand, in about 2006, and I am very pleased with his activities. No longer involved in administration and teaching, he has worked, I won't say full-time, but at least committed himself to continuing his research, which is on volcanism. And of course, he'll be talking about that in a few minutes. He has received some very important honors and awards. He's been an elected Erskine Fellow at the University of Canterbury in England in 1998. And more recently, he received the Alexander von Humboldt Research Prize in 2011. And that's a major recognition for his ability, not only as a researcher, but also in the writing ability and getting it published and worldwide acceptance. And he is also an elected fellow of the American Geophysical Union, and that's in 2014. So these awards and recognitions are continuing. But before I turn this back to Michael, I'd like to also point out, and this is to me is very important, Catherine and Jim, Jim's wife, have been married for 48 years. She has been a marvelous co-worker, supporter, helper in his life. And I'm very pleased to recognize her for that. But I think as important for her is that she has been described, and I saw it written somewhere, as a legendary high school teacher. She taught English in the English department at Santa Cruz High School for a number of years. Two of my daughters actually took English courses from her, and they confirmed legendary is an appropriate term. Not outstanding, not great, but legendary. Then she went on to teach English courses in the new charter school, the Pacific Collegiate Charter School, and very successful there as well. And then presently, she's very active on the board of the Santa Cruz County Music Symphony. And one of her real interests is getting more of the music into the grade schools and the younger generation so they can appreciate and meet people who actually are doing this. But Jim, I'm very pleased to have had this chance to probably go over the 5 minutes, but thank you very much, Jim. I am so proud.
Ask them to turn the top lights down because that will...
Okay, thank you, Bill. Yeah, could you turn the lights that are just above the stage down a wee bit? We may see the screen better. And thank you, Bill, and thank you, Michael. For those of you who don't know it, those two gentlemen have done as much for the creation of UC Santa Cruz as anybody, so it means a lot to have them introduce me. Thank you to all of you for coming. It's a testament a bit to volcanoes being an easy sell. They're in the news a lot. They're obviously beautiful to look at, to climb. They can be terrifying when they're erupting, and they're certainly humbling in their power and their complexity. The photograph that's in the top right is of a volcano in Indonesia where yet another alumna of UCSC who's in the audience went in the early 1980s. So it's the kind of thing that motivates people. Just as an advertisement, there's another talk about earth materials in two nights at the Grange Hall in Live Oak by two other emeriti. This is a bit more on the artistic side of rocks. But just to get us going on tonight, this I pulled down off the Guardian website. It's a movie made by people who, a company that manufactures drones. And they were showing off what their drones were capable of doing. So this is last fall. It's in Iceland, a volcano called Bergunga, that erupted for about 6 months. And this is one style of eruption that we'll talk about tonight. That's basaltic magma coming to the surface. It was a crack in the earth about 45 kilometers long. A dike injected into it. Most of the volcano is under ice, under almost a kilometer of ice, but this is the part that extends out beyond the ice. And as dramatic as that is, what this says at the bottom is that this is only about 10% the volume of what was erupted in 1783 when Americans were in Paris to negotiate the peace treaty at the end of the American Revolution. Benjamin Franklin was one of those people, and it was Franklin who, for the first time, put together the idea that a volcano of that scale, an eruption of that scale, caused changes in weather, because that winter was bitterly cold,
It was followed by a year without a summer, and it was Franklin who associated it with the eruption near that Birtubunga place in Iceland. It's also fitting that the talk comes near the bicentennial of the largest volcanic eruption, historical eruption on Earth, which was 200 years and 1 month ago from the volcano called Tambora, pictured here, on the island of Sumbawa, which is two east of Indonesia, in 1815. That's a hole in the mountain, top of the mountain, that's about 6 kilometers in diameter, that was either caused or at least enlarged by this one eruption that did all those things. And this is another one that has some historic significance, because that date is shortly before the Battle of Waterloo that ended the Napoleonic Wars. So it took place when Europe was already in turmoil, but it resulted in a very cold summer, a failure of crops, resulting famines, riots, epidemics, and all of those things. On the bad side, on the upside, doubtless some of you have seen beautiful sunset paintings by these folks. The sunsets were caused by that eruption halfway around the world. And even Frankenstein we owe to it, because Mary Shelley went to visit Lord Byron that summer expecting to do some hiking, and it was so cold that she just stayed around the fireplace and wrote the story. And all that was caused by the eruption of this much of what we're going to talk about next. So it's about 4 times that much fragmental material that was thrown up in the sky. That site is near the equator, and the magma was very high in sulfur. And so the sum of that much volume at that latitude with that composition caused this much climate change. And again, it was one of the first times. This is 30 years after the Laki basalt that Franklin talked about, when it was beginning to be appreciated that volcanoes had that effect. Oh, this is a volcano explosivity index. It's on a scale that's developed about 20 years ago, on a scale of 0 to 8, sort of to be like a Richter magnitude earthquake energy scale, some way to try to estimate energy of eruption. 8 is the biggest number. There's never been a historical one. So 7 is the biggest. And there's the other number 7. So that hole in the ground is also about 6 kilometers. This is a dead ringer for that Tambora thing. This erupted about 1,000 years before it and has been one of my own personal research agendas now for quite some time. So the name of the volcano is there. You would say it by one of these words, depending on what language you speak. It means perpetually white mountain. The photograph is taken a year ago summer at the lakeshore down around here. And the woman is Judy Feirstein, who's another alumna of the Earth Science Department, who I taught as an undergraduate and who went on the trip because she's a professional volcanologist with the USGS. The kicker is what's over here. The foreground is China, the background is North Korea. Most of the air fall from the eruption is in North Korea, and I have tried for 25 years to go. So this is an outline of what we're going to do tonight. There is a play on words in the title. So there are people for whom volcanoes and their eruptions are ends in themselves. And those are people who are properly called volcanologists. And they're heroes and heroines because they place themselves at risk for the public good. And I'm not one of them. For me, the volcanoes are a means to an end, another end. I use them to sample the interior of the Earth and to study the kinds of things that I'll talk about later tonight, how the crusts of our planet formed. You could think of the first as recreation. It's recreational for the people who go. They get to do something outdoors. They climb the mountains. It's almost recreation for the Earth. It gets rid of energy. But the same word is to recreate the Earth, and that's the scientific end to which I'm putting the volcanoes. So what's below that, those eight or so topics, are the things we're going to go through in the next 40 minutes. And since there's only 40 minutes, and each of those could be quite a long discussion, we'll have to go through them at some level of shallowness. So you're here in part because volcanoes in the news are in the news a lot, and they're in the news because they're erupting. So what does an active volcano mean? As of this morning, there were, on the international website that monitors this, 23 volcanoes that are active tonight. And that's a pretty typical number, and the majority of them are just emitting ash into the sky. That's usually accompanied by some earthquakes, the emission of gas, sometimes explosively. The volcano usually inflates a bit. All of those things may or may not be measured. So to be active means that one or more of those has been reported to somebody. Now, of those 23, there's 10 that have something red at the surface, at the volcano. The two that have been in the news the most have been Calbuco in southern Chile and the crater at Kilauea. But you'll notice, for example, that Berdabunga, that one we saw the movie of, is not even on the list because it stopped erupting 2 months ago. So to be an active volcano is also, there's a time frame involved. How recently has this thing been active? So typically, in any 1 year, for the last 60 years, there's been somewhere between 50 and 70 volcanoes that have popped off during that year for some time between days and months. Legally, in the US, if you're going to build something, then you have to know whether you're building on an active volcano. And so that definition is now as long as 10,000 years. If what you're going to build on is known to have erupted within 10,000 years, you need to plan as if it might erupt again. And that's wise, because the last bullet says that the majority of eruptions in the last century have come from a mountain that the people who lived next to the mountain prior to the eruption did not know could erupt. And that's because the repose time, the length of time since the last eruption, is sufficiently long that it makes any kind of land use planning very challenging. And it's even worse in a sense, because the longer the repose, the bigger the potential eruption could be. Now, another thing to say right at the beginning is that these are cartoons from textbooks. If you go far enough deep in the earth, there's something molten, but that doesn't erupt at the surface. So what does erupt at the surface comes from the upper 600 kilometers or so, this thing called the upper mantle, and it's entirely solid. Something has to happen to cause it to melt a little bit. And there's never really much melt there even. So what causes it to melt are these kind of cartoon arrows, namely that the mantle moves up, decompresses. And the act of decompression takes it across its melting point. So little bits of magma form where magma decompresses, in this case, beneath a place where two plates diverge from each other and the upwelling mantle fills the void, or where two plates converge on each other and melting takes place, for reasons you'll understand more a little later, above the descending plate. But in both cases, magmatism is simply the buoyancy of that little bit of melt where it can rise to the surface. So where does that mantle melt? And the answer is at the boundaries of tectonic plates. And so we just talked about what happens at mid-ocean ridges where two plates diverge from each other and mantle upwells to fill the void between, or places where they converge with each other and volcanoes occur on top of the overriding of the two plates, the one that does not descend into the earth. But there's also a none of the above category, something the Canary Islands or Hawaii, the Galapagos, where there are volcanoes that are not at a plate boundary and the mantle upwells for some other reason. But on our planet, the majority of volcanism takes place at those mid-ocean ridges, the diverging plate boundaries. And in any one, say, 100-kilometer-long segment of ridge, there are eruptions, we now know, at the scale of decades. sometimes centuries. There was one apparently 2 weeks ago at a place called Axial Seamount on the Juan de Fuca Ridge west of Oregon. No one has ever seen these. There's ocean in the way. And by the time a ship goes there, usually it's all over. So all you see are photographs. So these are pictures taken on the floor of the ocean underneath 2 kilometers or so of water by my colleagues, Dave Clegg at Ambari. And so I've been working with them on these mid-ocean ridges. That's the paper I'm writing this week. And these are the forms of lava with nothing on them. These are brand new things that form at the bottom of the ocean at mid-ocean ridges. Volumetrically, the next most common stuff is the sort that is at these hot spots in like Hawaii, where I'll say very little about them tonight, but they result in an upwelling of mantle that may be the deepest on the planet. And I'll say the most about the third type that form in island arcs later on. So what we'll talk about come in all three of those tectonic environments. And what comes out at the surface when it's red is magma. And so magma has all three phases of matter, solids, liquids, and gases. The liquid part is the most obvious. It's the melt. And what forms deep in the mantle starts off as 100% melt. But as it ascends and cools, some solid things begin to precipitate from it as crystals. And gases that were dissolved in the melt at high pressure begin to undissolve or exsolve at low pressure. And the analogy is shaking up a carbonated beverage, taking off the lid, and all the foam comes out. That's the same thing as the gas coming out of the melt. So the melts start off in the mantle as basalt. And the mantles of all terrestrial planets, when melted, produce a magma that is given the name basalt. It's relatively high temperature. It's quite low viscosity, very fluid, so it flows almost like water. It makes lava flows that are relatively thin, a few feet. It's about 50% SiO2, which is the lowest of these things we'll talk about, and 5 to 10 weight percent magnesium oxide, which is the highest of these magmas that we'll talk about. And everything else changes from them by the withdrawal, by the separation of the solids from the liquids. Because the solids, the crystals, have a different chemical composition than the liquid, so if you can separate the two from each other, the liquid will have changed in composition. So if you take out about 50% of those solids, what you wind up with is a liquid has now a higher silica content, a lower magnesium content, and gets a different name. And the name for that second most common type of magma comes from the Andes Mountains. It's an Andes rock, an andesite. And it's colder and stickier and makes thicker lava flows and explodes more oftenly than basalt. And if you continue that process to have the highest silica content, the lowest magnesium content, then the name given to that is a rhyolite, and it's the most dramatic in its eruption. So this is the stuff of the National Geographic articles about super eruptions in Yellowstone. And it's what you've all seen when you've been to Yosemite as a granite pluton. And that was a rhyolite magma that was stillborn, that never erupted, froze inside the earth. So basalts are the most fundamental. But part of what my career has been is to find out that in every one of those tectonic settings, the spreading ridges and the subduction zones and the ocean islands, the basalts in each of those cases differ for reasons about their source. I've also spent a good bit of my career trying to determine the time scale by which those processes occur. Between the formation of the melt in the mantle and its eruption at the surface, how long does that take? What is the age of that magma at the time of its eruption? And the answer is that the stuff happens very fast, and that the magmatic processes are as young as the chronometers we have to measure them. They happen at human timescales. The changes take place at human timescales. When the magma erupts, what's formed at the surface, if the magma stays together, if it stays intact, is a lava. So that's what we saw erupting there at the Berdabunga. But if it flies apart, if it's fragmented by gas explosion on eruption, then those hot fragments are pyroclasts. And the resulting deposit is not a lava, but it's a hot sediment that forms from magmatic materials at the surface. All of those are what happens if the magma erupts. If it doesn't erupt, it's stuck in the earth, then it's a pluton, like the granites. All right, now if it makes it to the surface, if it erupts, then there's an orifice from which it erupts, and that's what we call a volcano. And there's many kinds because there's many styles of eruption. So these words are counterclockwise from the lower left. So I'm starting here because I think that's most people's stereotypical vision of a volcano. That could be Mount Shasta or Mount Fuji. This actually is Cotopaxi, the highest volcano on the planet in Ecuador, where Catherine and I were about a month ago. In fact, we climbed up in here to the snow at the bottom of this thing. So the slopes, all that topography you can see, including the thing that's here in the foreground, those are andesite lava flows. So what a stratovolcano is dominated by andesitic magma that has stuck together and formed lava, or blown apart to form these hot clastic sediments that together are the strata of the stratovolcano. At the very top of the mountain, the andesite lava can be so viscous, so cold, it's very hot, but I mean, relatively speaking, that it can't flow very far and is simply a little mountain inside of a mountain. So this is called a dome. This is Mount St. Helens after the 1980 eruption, where a new thing, a new dome, has risen into the throat of the volcano. So both of these are dominated by andesitic materials. The two at the top are by basaltic ones. So this one is from Mexico. And this is a cinder cone. That is, all that black stuff around the outside are the sort of things that some of you might have in your front lawn, those little red, frothy cinders. So they've been formed by an eruption that comes right out of the middle of it, throws all the cinders up in the sky. They land at an angle of repose. That whole thing probably formed in the course of months to a couple of years. It's a one-off. It'll probably never be used again. It was just a burp. On land. If the same sort of thing, though, happens near sea level, then it also makes cone-shaped things. Note that the slopes here are more gentle because there's been more water involved in this. Here, the gas that created the explosions for the cinders was gas that came out of the magma, that exsolution process. Over here, the water is surface water, seawater, in fact, where the ground is saturated in water. Magma comes up near the surface, flashes it to steam, and these are tuff, T-U-F-F cones on the edge of big things that look like that. So this is a France Atlantic photograph. This is the island of San Isabel in the Galapagos. That's Fernandina in the background. So that is the last of these words. That's a shield that's made up of 100% basalt lava flow, those hot, thin things that don't make nice steep shapes, that make quite flat ones. And then around the perimeter of them are these tuff cones. So there's more words than that, but gives you a sense of the diversity. Those are things that, of course, that are subaerial, on land. The majority of volcanoes on the planet are underwater. Like Bill said, we have a marine science institute here, and I got to play underwater. And this is our family favorite volcano. The New Zealanders discovered that. Here's North Island, New Zealand down here. And they did a lot of surveying and ran across this thing. This volcano is the same size as Cotopaxi. It's just, it's all underwater. And they named it for me. And we were down there several years ago, and they presented us with this map and some rocks that came from the volcano and so on. And a year ago, so some of you know our daughter, Emily. She lives right there. She can look out her window to something called White Island, which is an erupting volcano here. But if she could see further, then she'd see Dad's volcano. A year ago right now, I was on that ship. That's a huge drill ship with a drill rig in the middle of it. And at one point, we hung 4 kilometers of pipe down that drill thing right through the middle of the ship and drilled into a volcano just like this one to see what its history was. We drilled 2,000 meters into the volcano, dead. But the volcano we went to was in Japan. So there's lots of these things on the floor of the ocean. All right, so we talked about magmas and eruptions, or magmas and volcanoes. So now we get onto the dramatic stuff, what happens when they erupt. And there's lots of words, lots of descriptions of eruption types, but all of them are a function of 3 V's. Viscosity, fluidity of the melt, volume, how much stuff comes out, and volatiles, the gases. And what makes the difference between the way one volcano erupts and another, or even the same volcano one time versus another, is the ascent rate of the gas compared to the melt. If the gas stays in the melt, then we're all relatively safe being nearby, we can watch it. But if the gas gets out a lot faster than the melt, then the whole thing froths and explodes. So the relatively safe kind are called Hawaiian. So this has been in the news of late. So this, if you can see it, is the caldera floor of Kilauea, and this is the crater, the Halemaumau. And just within the last 10 days or so, the basaltic magma has filled up the crater and is now overflowing. And this happened in the late 19th century, where for a period of, I think, 30 years or so, there was a lake of lava at Kilauea, and you could have your breakfast at the volcano house and peer over into the abyss, and that may happen again. So here's the kind of statistics of these things. They're relatively small volume, relatively benign eruptions, but they make for great footage on the TV shows at night. This is a photograph of the East Rift System of Hawaii, where a lot of the, say, subdivisions, housing subdivisions that get a lava in the backyard, they're out here. But as I say, they're relatively small volume. Here's a photograph taken, I'm not sure, you know, recently, of that, the site of that eruption in 1783, where the volume of this now is substantially more than, this happened in 9 months, that happened in 30 years. And it makes these, here's little cinder cones, and here's this long surface expression of a dike where things like the Bertabunga eruption occurred. All right, if there's more gas, and if the gas is now coming through that basalt magma more rapidly than the magma's coming, then if it comes out in a pulsed fashion, bursts of explosions, and then dies down, and then a burst of explosion, and then it dies down. The name given to that is Strombolian, from an island, Stromboli, that's just north of Sicily. And you'll see that it's, let's see, it produces explosions that are minutes to hours apart. Well, if you can get onto Stromboli, and you can find out whether on that day it's minutes or hours. And if it's hours, you can figure out how many hours. And if you're lucky, or I guess, you can actually climb right up there and peek in before the next explosion. All right. Now, if the gas stays in, but the magma is now that andesite stuff, colder, higher silica content, several orders of magnitude more viscous, then it's forming remember that dome picture of Mount St. Helens? Well, this is a dome that's forming in this volcano called Kelud, which is in eastern Java. That wall of things, it's not vertical, maybe it's 50-degree slope, 60-degree slope, that's maybe twice the size of this building. It's a five-story building of molten material standing there. And there, this is taken at night, so there are boulders falling off, breaking off, gravitationally cascading down the side. That's what gives it all this drama. But that's molten. It's not 100% melt, it's not 100% solid, it's somewhere in between the two. And it's just oozing out of the ground, but staying largely together. And as you came in, I was playing a CD that Catherine and I got in Montserrat, this island in the Antilles, when we were there several weeks ago for a science meeting. And it's probably the best studied example of an intrusion. So there's this dome forming in the background. Here's the cartoon of the guy who you saw a picture of in the movie as you walked in, of the gas rising up into the dome. And there's about 5 days in 1997, and you can see that there's a rhythmicity, a periodicity of earthquakes and gas emission and deformation of the mountain. It's breathing. It's inhaling, it's exhaling. And they've collected the rocks on those days, and they can watch the crystals form as all those things take place. So it's probably the best documented dome eruption that there's been. All right, but the one that I think gets all of our attention the most are these things. So if there's enough gas, then that dome doesn't stand a chance. And the magma is ejected in a vertical column where there's enough force to hold up all of its entrained materials, all of the magma particles, these are solid things, to hold up, blast them up into the sky until there's some level where it's reached neutral buoyancy. So a mushroom cloud has a mushroom cap because there's got to be some place, it can't go forever, where it reaches the same density as the surroundings. And you can see this is the one that was, this is Vesuvius. This is the first description of a volcanic eruption that's written down. You can see even in this thing that the wind is blowing right to left because it's asymmetric. And they've drawn it with the black stuff falling on this side, not on that side. So the wind is blowing this way, and there's a quantitative relationship between the energy that's involved to take it to that height, the quantitative relationship between that height, this dimension, and the vector of the wind. Vesuvius, that many of you have probably been to Pompeii and Herculaneum, this eruption lasted 2 days. It had two components, the first of which is this ash fall from the top of that cloud. And that lasted about half a day. And that's what dumped all the stuff on Pompeii and caused the roofs to collapse. But then that column collapsed. The energy down here, either this thing became wider or it ran out of gas that was driving the eruption, but the energy involved decreased substantially. And what went up came down. And what's coming down is magma, fragmental magma. And so what happened, not shown here, what happened in the second half of the eruption was a pyroclastic flow that ran, in this case, 200 to 300 degrees centigrade. And that's what took out Herculaneum. And part of it went over Pompeii as well. Anybody left after the first part? Ended after the second. So the scale of this diagram at the bottom is how high that cloud went, the plume height. So the stratosphere is about 25 kilometers, depending on where you are in latitude. So the name given to something that reaches the stratosphere is a planitic eruption, and it usually scales with the rate at which mass is ejected, and that's just a summary of some of the historical examples. And now here's the other movie that I wanted to show you. And can you turn down that light a little bit for me? So this is one of the volcanoes that is erupting today. This is called Sinabung. It's in the northwestern end of Sumatra. It's adjacent to, it's the closest volcano to the site of the most recent VEI-8 eruption on the planet. 74,000 years ago, a place called Lake Toba in northernmost Sumatra. And that's why it got everybody's attention. So this started around 2010. It's been 5 years now. This continues, I think, this week. What I read, that there's been one of these roughly every 2 or 3 hours. And they extend some 2 or 3 kilometers down the sides. Let me just see, where do I want to go with this? What I say by humbling. So as I've written at the top, this stuff is coming at you or coming at somebody at hundreds of kilometers an hour. It's hundreds of degrees centigrade. It's traveling kilometers. It's not as low density as water, but it's low enough that it can jump topography. So even if you think you're in the next valley, that's not necessarily to your benefit. And it's either the collapse of that Kellud dome, that thing that was sitting there, red and menacing. What if, when that just fails, you get these things? That's what's happening in Montserrat. But those eruption columns, like Pliny saw, when that column collapses, then you get them as well. All right. Next topic is an economic one. So here's a list of metals down here, gold, silver, copper, lead, zinc, molybdenum, that we all use most of the time, and most of what we use come from volcanoes. So the deposits of those ores form at the top of and at the top and the sides of the magma bodies, and they form quickly, apparently, within years, again, human time scales, but it's a Goldilocks situation. The volcano has to be just right. It has to have enough of those metals in the melt. It has the whole thing be under compression, the melt, but especially the gas has to have the right oxidation state, the right pH, the right chlorine content, the right sulfur content. It has to have not lost all of its gas, still have some left, and if all that's right, maybe 1 out of 1,000 times, a volcano will leave an ore deposit behind. So at the meetings I go to, the people who are there wearing better clothes than me are the people who are looking for the metals. All right. So I said all this was a means to an end for me. So let me say a few things here at the end about the reasons that I study them, which is the one I chose is how continents form, because continents are a specialty of our planet. And somehow they're related to the oceans, or at least the water, condensed water on our planet, which in turn is related to the subduction zones, the convergent plate boundaries. Without those things, we wouldn't have continents, obviously. Without the continents, we wouldn't be here ourselves. So when UCSC was founded, plate tectonics had just happened. In fact, Santa Cruz is the only major university in the US which created an earth science geology type department at the most crucial point in the history of our discipline, namely the the plate tectonics revolution. And it was obvious quickly that there were geochemical consequences to that. And the point two is that these two people figured out that if you melt the mantle of the Earth at a mid-ocean ridge, you'll produce basalt, and they did the experiments to prove that that was true. And then the brother of the first person, working with the second person, this T. Green, realized that if you took his older brother's basalts and melted them at high pressure, what you got was an andesite. And then this other two people in number four figured out that those andesites had trace metal compositions, chemical compositions, that were pretty good matches to some of the continental crust. And so it seemed in the mid-60s as if you melted the mantle at mid-ocean ridges to produce the basalt, you melted the basalt at subduction zones to produce the andesites, and the andesites were the continents, and it was all over. Well, Misters D. Green and Ringwood and Taylor all became members of the National Academy for that kind of stuff. And so when I was a young grad student, I went to the Australian National University to study with them. Within 4 years, I realized they were wrong. And that notoriety, I guess you'd say, probably helped me get hired here. So I've spent a lot of my life, this is less of a cartoon, more of a data summary, of these subduction zones. And I thought of spending my whole evening talking about this, but then I realized you'd probably be more interested in seeing pictures of volcanoes. But briefly, this is a converging plate boundary. So here's one plate arriving from the east. So this is a cross-section of northern Honshu in Japan. You're looking north, so east is to the right. The Pacific plate is being subducted, thrust underneath the overlying Eurasian plate. All these little circles are earthquakes marking the pushing of this colder plate under that one. Over here, the Pacific plate has been under the Pacific Ocean, so therefore the oceanic crust shown here in blue is several weight percent water. By the time it gets to about 100 kilometers underneath Japan, most of that water has been pushed out, has been dehydrated, lost to the overlying mantle. And it's that process of losing the water and the effects on this mantle for both strength and melting point that causes the volcanoes of Japan. So back here a little bit, for example, in this textbook, it shows that that oceanic crust is melting to produce this subduction zone, this island arc. But I've X'd out melting of oceanic crust because what's melting is the mantle above it. And it's melting as a consequence of things that are added at the bottom, but the melting takes place, most of it. The red, and the colors on this are the velocities of P waves. The red color is the lowest velocity, the things that will have that 1% melt in it. And down here, there's no evidence of the melt. So scientifically, this is the sort of thing that I actually do for a living. I work on the things on the left. I go out and collect samples, I measure things, I make calculations about things, and the bottom line of what I'm trying to do is to compare the results of my calculations and observations on the one hand to the magmas that are erupted, to that red stuff out of the volcano. So for me, it doesn't matter usually whether it's red or not. I just go to the volcano, I know that Fuji has erupted something like that, and I'm trying to explain it. And then I'm trying to explain why Fuji is different from Shasta or different from Gill volcano or something else. And on the right are the kinds of conclusions that I and people like me have come to over the years. And we can come back to this if anybody's interested in it, but just it gives you a sense, if you read quickly, of the sorts of day-to-day research that I do. And more on a human scale, what does it take for somebody like me to do something like that? Well, first I have to have a good idea, and then I have to plan an expeditionary science that goes to some place to collect the right samples to test those ideas. That costs money, so I have to raise that. The university doesn't provide it. Then I've got to recruit people to do it with, like people who are in the audience. then I've got to get them there and back safely, and once we're there, collect the right stuff to answer the questions, and then it's got to come back to a laboratory here in Santa Cruz where there's equipment that can be used to study the samples. Then the samples have to be prepared for study in a way that doesn't contaminate them. And they've got to be analyzed with a high degree of accuracy and precision. Then I've got to use that data to create and test hypotheses, ultimately write it all up. That takes quite a while. But that's what's involved for me in using a volcano. So real quickly, when I quit being an administrator, I learned that one of the most adventuresome experiments being done in earth science in my field was being done in Japan. And they were in the process of imaging the surface, the uppermost part of the earth, at a level of detail nobody had ever done before. They were doing it as a submission to the law of the sea. They were out to prove that the land underwater around Japan belonged to Japan. But their way of doing it was to determine whether or not it was continental. So these are their results. This is the top 50 kilometers or so of the Earth. You're looking east. There's the Pacific plate coming at you. So that's California's way up there. And this is a line right down the volcanoes that are between Tokyo, so north is to the left, and Iwo Jima, off south to the right. So that's about 1,000 kilometers. And the colors are shown here. That's the velocity of P waves in the Earth. So the dark blue is about 8 kilometers per second, and that's that mantle stuff, the part of the Earth that could melt to give something. And if this was anywhere else in the oceans, what would be on top of it would be about 5 to 7 kilometers thick, and would have a particular velocity structure. And specifically, it wouldn't have any of that lurid green stuff, which turns out to be about this speed of wave speed. So what they discovered for the first time ever was that there was continental crust formed in the oceans. They were happy because they had a lot of it, and they helped them be successful saying it belonged to Japan. But in addition, you can see that green stuff is not very uniform in thickness. It gets thick and thin, so on. It's like a snake that ate mice. And here's, I think the red line is how thick that middle layer is. And every time the middle layer is quite thick, you go up to the surface and there's a big basalt volcano there. And where that layer is thin, go up to the surface, and there's a rhyolite volcano there. And one of the team that discovered all this, Mr. Tamura, came here to Santa Cruz for a year. His kids went to Gateway School. We studied all this stuff. And we realized that there were differences in the kind of things we could measure at Santa Cruz between those volcanoes. They were related to the thickness. So the formation of this characteristic stuff that makes a continent was happening at the subduction zone. So continental crust is important. There's not a whole lot of it, but it's got most of the elements of interest to us in it. It's relatively low density. Once you make it, it's hard to get rid of it. And there's patterns in age. So this is more than 2.5 billion years old, the dark blue. The yellow, like where we're living, is less than 200 million years old in general. It's a cartoon, but here's a photograph from space of that thing. So the dark blue is this light-colored stuff. The green is the dark-colored stuff. There are pods of old continent surrounded by slightly younger continent, and in places like North America, it's gradational. So the continents have a pattern in their age. So how old is old? So the photograph on the left is one of my other PhD supervisors at ANU. And one of my fellow grad students for his PhD designed the ion optics of this piece of equipment behind, which was used to create the results on the right. So the numbers that are over here are ages in thousands of millions of years of parts of two different zircon crystals. Check out those numbers, 4.3 billion years old. Zircons remember a long time. So, Compton, with his equipment, enabled a discovery that's been just taken over the field in the last 20 years or so. And my post-administrative career, have participated in that a little bit. So here's a graph that shows, remember, here's all these ages. You know, how many, 6 ages on 2 different zircon crystals. So here's those same numbers. So age of the Earth, 4.5 billion over there. This is the number of uranium-lead ages on zircon crystals that have been collected in the last 20 years. And it's like 20,000 of them there, thanks to Compton. And you can see that they're not randomly distributed with time. There's lots of zircons at 2,700 million years and a whole lot more at 1,900 million years and so on. So there's a breathing of the Earth, not just of a volcano, but the Earth is pulsed. And there's a big debate whether what's being pulsed there is the frequency in which crust of the Earth is created that would precipitate a zircon, or frequency with which that crust once created gets preserved by collisions and subduction zones. Remember that zircons, that's the chemical formula of a zircon. It has in it essential mineral called element called hafnium and oxygen, and both of those elements have isotopic compositions that are different between the crust of the Earth and the mantle. So in your zircon, when it's 4.3 billion years old, you can ask, well, how much of that hafnium and how much of that oxygen in that zircon came out of the mantle recently, and how much has been in the crust a long time? As you can screen all those numbers, try to get some idea of what the new zircon, new magma from the interior of the Earth has been, and this is one, the most recent summary of it. Not everybody agrees with this, but it says that roughly 2/3 of the crust of the Earth was created before 3 million years ago. And all we've been doing ever since is that last third, and so we've been recycling a lot of what formed at the beginning. So this is my last summary slide. And it says that all that subduction stuff that I've been giving my life to, it is continental in a way, at least geophysically it is, but not geochemically, which of course is what I care about the most. And that the oldest parts of our continental crust came before subduction really got going, our modern kind that we understand. So therefore, the subduction is recycling the continents more than it's making them. In fact, subduction is even recycling the oceans. Remember I said that oceanic crust was several weight percent water? Well, you do that by the volume of the stuff that we subduct the entire oceans roughly every billion years. So all of that, as far as we know, is unique to our planet. This is the sequence of thoughts that I've tried to take you through tonight. Volcanoes, for me, are means to that end, but they're obviously wonderful ends in themselves. So I close with that last thought on the upper right. Those of you who enjoy California wine, you do so at the mercy and thanks of volcanoes, because they're growing in volcanic soil. And we had a dinner party at our house on Friday night, served that bottle of wine, and notice the name on it? It's called Eruption. And it's grown in soil in the closest volcano to UC Santa Cruz, which is at Clear Lake. The photograph on the bottom is the one with which I started. And I want to especially thank Debbie Schwartz, who's here in the audience, who's the only person, one of the few people on the planet, who's been to that volcano. Thank you. So there are people here with a microphone. And if you'd like to ask questions, I'll do the best I can to answer them, but just wait for the microphone.
Yes, Jim. The cooling of the Earth eventually, presumably, will stop this process, or all these processes. When will that happen, and what will the Earth be like then?
By when?
By when.
So what will cause all this to end?
Yes.
So most of what drives all this is the heat internal to the Earth, which is partly residual heat from the formation of the planet, from the accretionary energy with things falling together, and partly the radioactive decay of uranium, potassium, thorium in the Earth. With any luck, we've got at least 5 billion years more to go. So logic says, and to the extent that there is a measurement, that we are cooling down. Things are less vigorous than they once were. But compare us to Venus, our sister planet, almost every respect like us. No plate tectonics. No, as far as we know, we're the only planet, only silicate planet, maybe anywhere in the universe that's doing this. So it's just this right combination of how much water did we have, how much residual heat did we have, how long will it last? Venus may have had it for a while, but it's over. Mars may have had it for a while, but it's over. We're going to have it for a while. Don't be bashful. One up in the back.
Jim, you mentioned the Canary Islands. Would you speak a little bit about what makes them different? Because you mentioned that there's subduction zones and rift zones, but it's a hot
different
spot.
From what? Hawaii or from Mount St. Helens?
Mount St. Helens.
So Canary Islands, like Hawaii or like Galapagos, are one of these places where there is a point source of heat, conceivably as deep as the core, mantle core boundary, more likely in most cases shallower than that, but some fixed point of heat that keeps producing melt for tens or at least scores of millions of years in one place. So the plates are moving over that one place, and so you get chains of islands, younger at one end where it's over that point, older where it's away from that point. But there's no water, nothing of that subduction process that is dehydrating something that used to be at the surface. So the only thing that can melt is the mantle. So in that sense, it's more like a mid-ocean ridge than it is like Mount St. Helens. But it's even different from a mid-ocean ridge because for all of the ocean islands that we know about, there's a component that's present in the ocean islands that's not present at the mid-ocean ridges that is ancient. And that is, in some cases, it may be material that's primordial, that the Galapagos, Hawaii, Iceland all have helium isotope, rare gas isotope ratios that are best explained by something that has never outgassed. It's been there since 4.5 billion years, and it's coming up now in those places. So ocean islands are special in that respect. Canaries, and each one is a slightly different flavor, but the Canaries are one case like that. Hawaii, Galapagos, Iceland, Azores. Here you are.
Some time ago, I heard that Yellowstone was on one of those hot spots, which is not an island out in the middle of the ocean. Is it still considered one of those hot
yes.
spots?
And
has
those And
it is characteristics?
Considered that way for two. So the question is Yellowstone a hot spot like the Canary Islands are a hot spot? And the answer seems to be yes, for two reasons. One, seismic imaging into the Earth shows low velocities that extend almost 1,000 kilometers under Yellowstone, deeper than under the Canaries, deeper than under Hawaii, for that matter. So there's some geophysical expression of heat that goes very deep. And two, this rare gas stuff, Yellowstone has it too. So there's a chain that Yellowstone is at the eastern end of that goes right down the Snake River Plain. So what we see now in Yellowstone, up to about, I think, 10 or 15 million years ago, you backtrack it, and there's other Yellowstones that have been through there too, and it's just the most recent one. Catherine and I were lucky last fall to be in the backcountry of Yellowstone with a colleague who's one of the people, one of the volcanology types who works there. And I think what he would want me to tell you is, don't believe the hype about super eruptions. If Yellowstone has ever had them, the chances of them being again in human history are very small. And the consequence for the park of the hype is deleterious, that people are afraid of it, don't go to it, or they go and expect the wrong things. So yes, it has produced large eruptions. The last one was about 640,000 years ago. And they pop off every million years or so. So, you know, sometime in the next few hundred thousand years, it could go again. But don't cancel your vacation.
Can you speculate about how those early crusts formed, the continental crusts? You say that it's not understood and it's not analogous to today, but...
That's really hard. So, certainly there are many people who, giving the same talk, would not show that slide. And they would show instead that slide. So there's several different people's views of, the vertical bars are those same sort of things. It's an older version of it, but these are how many zircons of a certain age there were at that time. But all these black lines are these different people's published, so they went through peer review, understandings of the rate at which continental crust was formed. Well, if you went to the extreme one, Mr. Fife, who oddly enough almost became Dean of Science at Santa Cruz, he thought it all formed right at the very beginning. cumulative on this one, I went on the right. What makes it especially hard to answer, the first part of the answer is it's very model dependent and it's how you interpret those zircons. All these things are pre-zircon. This came from other ideas. So I think that what I showed you for zircon is one of two live possibilities. But the other is that there is isotopic evidence that crust formed in the Earth within the first 50 to 100 million years that Earth existed, at the very, very beginning. And its only expression is in isotopic ratios that are different between the Earth and the Moon, subtly. It's taken until the last 10 years for there to be enough precision of measurement to even know that. But it's unquestionably true. So there was something that happened right at the very beginning that created some crust. Did it survive? Did it last? The oldest rock we have is about 4.1 billion. The planet's 4.5 something billion. So there's half a billion years where there's no rocks. There's the odd zircon, but there's no rocks. So whatever was created isn't here at the surface in any recognizable form. So that's the big mystery. Then the second one is, when did subduction start? That's again debated, but the answer seems to be most commonly somewhere around 3. So for the first third of Earth history, which might be 2/3 of the continental crust, it still is a wild west of science.
Hi, I have two questions. I wanted to know, just relating to how volcanism has changed, how good do you feel it would be to compare it to, for example, volcanism on Mars? And then my second question is...
What was the first to compare it to?
Oh, volcanism on Earth changing from just not having tectonics to having tectonics compared to Mars, from what I understand, it has no tectonics. Mm. Mm-hmm. And then my second one is, what do you recommend for us students? What's your words of wisdom for us?
As to what part of all this to study?
Sure.
Comparative planets. You know, how? Gary, do you want to take that one? obviously, the two things that make our planet most distinctive is the liquid water and the continent, and they're linked somehow. So a Venus without a way to sequester the carbon, without a way to have carbonate sediments forming somewhere, just as a runaway greenhouse, and is a very unpleasant place to live. So we sequester the carbonates in part on the continents, or in the shells of the continents, and in part we subduct the stuff. As to why we're lucky to have subduction. You know, and again, all I can say is it's a balance between the heat of the planet, the formation of the core, which affects then the melting temperature of what's left. So it's got the melting temperature, the heat, and the water content, which affects both strength and melting point, are just in this lucky balance that we have. And whether other planets had it once and lost it, and if so, what caused them to lose it, you're beyond my pay grade, I think, at that point. And obviously, all of that kind of stuff is fascinating to study, but it may be attractable to study. What would I say to anybody who was interested in volcanoes and as a student? Most of volcanoes as an end in themselves, which I think is a noble calling, it's hard to get a job. So most of the people who do that work for government agencies. And it's a risky job. And most of them are physicists or geologists, people who don't work in a laboratory, who go out with boots and climb around and bang on rocks and things. And there's both of those interacting with each other. When we were 3 weeks ago at this observatory in Montserrat, they were all people your age. There weren't any old folks. They were young, keen scientists who were dedicating themselves to trying to understand something that put the public at risk. And what better job can you have than that? Yeah.
Jim, I'd like to ask you a question, if I may. It's really on a subject that you did not cover. These volcanoes are extremely devastating. Historically, they usually hundreds of thousands of people die because of them. And so what the average person wants to know is, like with earthquakes, what can be done towards prediction of when a volcanic eruption may occur and when it... Now, as a physicist, I learned recently that they have been using cosmic rays, muons, to actually measure the flow, just like you know they did with the what they did with the pyramid caves, finding where the holes are and so forth. You can find something about the structure of
density.
The room. Mm-hmm. Could you comment a little bit about that? And
well, the big question about prediction, I think, is huge in any geophysical field. So think of all of us, so we want to know what the weather is going to be like tomorrow. And we all complain because it's not the way someone predicted it to be. Well, the weather is at least changing every few days. And so you can, if you've made a mistake tomorrow, you can learn from it and you can revise your model. And yet still how hard it is to do that. Well, earthquakes are a little bit better than that because they occur with greater periodicity. But I think there's very few seismologists who think you can predict an earthquake. And many seismologists would say, don't even spend money on trying to predict earthquakes. Spend money on engineering. Design the building to withstand it because you know it's going to happen. And and volcanoes are the worst of all, because of that long repose time, those hundreds of years that can take place. So the more repetitive the volcano is, the better it can be predicted. So Montserrat, where we just were, there, somebody's wearing a beeper. A certain number of earthquakes or a certain change in tilt, his beeper rings. So they can predict things now because they've lived with it for 15 years relatively well. What they can't predict is the magnitude of what will happen, and that's what really matters. Do you evacuate people or don't you? Because just think of the cost of the evacuation and think of the consequence for the people who've left their home of the evacuation. So I'd say in all cases for volcanoes, you get maps and you say, if you live in this area, you are vulnerable. So sign here that you acknowledge your vulnerability. And there are places where you shouldn't live, but we live in, here in Santa Cruz. There's all kinds of housing around here which shouldn't be there. And so the person who buys the house has a short memory or runs the risk, and volcanoes are extremely that way. So I'd say with volcanoes, the prediction is more what area is likely to receive what consequence given the history of that volcano. Here, what, could you take a... Mm-hmm. Well, you quoted me correctly, might be. So I didn't say we're the only ones who have it because no one could possibly say that. But the question for those of you who didn't hear it is, given all the multitude of stars and the possibility of planets and how many planets are being discovered all the time, how rare is Earth? How unique is this? Well, we can certainly say with confidence we're unique in the solar system. All right, so we know that. Beyond that, I'd say this is philosophical or theological. Some of you heard Sandy Faber give a talk maybe last year or 2 years ago, where she wound up saying Earth is pretty unique. But in general, I would say your question, astronomers tend to think there's such an infinite possibility, there's got to be somebody out there like us, SETI Institute. And geologists tend to think rare Earth. Even if our planet could have all those, even it did have plate tectonics, 252 million years ago, there was a volcanic eruption in what's now Siberia that wiped out over 90% of living things on the planet. We basically started all over again. And that's what, that was the biggest, but it's big things like that have happened again. So geologists tend to be more stochastic about things, that the chances of this all being repeated in quite the same way are pretty small. But that's, say, philosophical. Yes? Yes?
Bringing this back to the question of predictability, a number of years ago, and maybe a couple decades ago, there was concern about Mammoth.
Yes.
And eruption, and it was in the news a lot, and was that hype, or was that some...
So the question is predictability, and specifically Mammoth Mountain. I think for many people who work in the volcano business for the Geological Survey, if you ask them, where is the next likely eruption in California, they would say Mammoth. The story that I just, that I it seared in my brain was after Mount St. Helens, about a year later, the people who were responsible for civil defense and evacuating people at Mount St. Helens had a weekend retreat, what have we learned kind of thing. And they went to Mammoth. This is 1982. And they're sitting in the room in Mammoth and they felt the very same rhythmic vibrations. It's called tremor. It's like sitting in a cathedral in Europe and listening to the pipe organ that's so deep you can't hear it, but you can feel it. That's what they felt, and they said, oh, shit. So for some years after that, If you bought or sold property in Mammoth, and it was taken so seriously, it was not hype, it was taken so seriously, you had to sign as one of those many documents, you know, I acknowledge that there might be a volcanic eruption here. So the whole place inflated for a period of several years, maybe five, and then it stopped. So there have been some large earthquakes. I'm at the edge of my knowledge here, but there have been some large earthquakes since then, but that the tremor and the inflation stopped. What the most likely thing to happen, though, Mammoth Mountain itself is only 100,000 years old. It's a volcano. People have died at Mammoth Mountain with the carbon gases being released today from it. There's dead areas of the mountain with dead trees on it because of the carbon gases that are coming out. There's still magma there. But the most likely thing to happen would be one of those little basalt eruptions. Kind of cool to watch. As long as you're not right there, if you're a couple of miles away, it'd just be really fascinating. And so that's what's happened most recently at Mammoth. But Mammoth, like Yellowstone, had one of those massive eruptions, a VEI-8 eruption with 1,000 cubic kilometers worth of stuff that came out, and that was about 750,000 years ago. So it's taken seriously. Okay, thank you.